I guess it's an indication that other people are paying attention to the same things I'm noticing. Rachel Maddow yesterday on MSNBC did a segment explaining how Donald Trump is exploiting his black audience, his black supporter network, his black voters, or those that consider themselves Trump supporters. It kind of piggybacks on my previous video. I recorded an interview yesterday with Garrison Hayes about black Republicans that posted at 3 p.m. This is posting at 4. I'm going to play this for you because more people are waking up to the grift, the game, the charlatan nature of Donald Trump related to exploiting and taking advantage of black Americans who are, for whatever reason, disillusioned or questioning whether they want to vote for Joe Biden. I'm going to play this clip from Rachel Maddow, and it is fantastic. And then we're going to really kind of go through the narrative that surrounds Donald Trump and the right-wing propaganda networks that are forwarding the notion that he is reaching out to black voters when it's all a ruse. It's absolutely just theater. It's just what it is that when Donald Trump claims he's going to a black church to promote the idea of blacks for Trump, and then they pan through the crowd, and it's just a bunch of goofy white people who are there for Donald Trump. They're in a black church. It's a black church, and there's nary a black face to be seen because they don't, in large measure, support Donald Trump, and especially support Donald Trump's policies, which back white supremacy. Here's Rachel Maddow, and then we'll move on.
But he goes to this black church in Detroit, and his campaign does not take any steps to avoid the pews being completely filled with white people, with white Trump supporters. Then on the day, the message of his supposed campaign is that he's trying to appeal to black voters, right? That's the whole point of doing this photo op. He then goes straight from that venue, stuffed with white people, to a conference hosted by this guy who has been in the news for the last few months for saying, quote, "We made a huge mistake when we passed the Civil Rights Act in the 1960s, saying that he thinks black people are not qualified to be airline pilots, that he worries if he's on a flight and sees that the pilot is black, who has been posting things like, quote, whiteness is great on social media, who has been hosting guests on his podcast to talk about how black people are inherently biologically inferior and incapable of advanced intelligence. Someone who said literally MLK, meaning Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., quote, MLK was awful, not a good person. So on the day, your campaign message is, hey, black voters, look at me. Aren't I appealing? Going from the black church that's inexplicably full of white people right from there to go do an appearance with the MLK was awful and the Civil Rights Act was a mistake guy. If that's how you're running your campaign, you are not trying very hard in normal campaign terms. But they are not trying very hard in normal campaign terms. They're not trying very hard to compete on normal political appeals. What they are trying to do instead is take power by menacing and chasing out of the country anyone who opposes their leader.
And that last part about chasing out and menacing anybody who questions the leader, who challenges the leader, that goes for not just the DOJ, that goes for not just opponents like me in independent media or traditional media. That goes for voters. That goes for the manner with which Steve Bannon talks about it, Donald Trump talks about it, Charlie Kirk himself talks about it, is that we will crush the opposition. They don't delineate between how much power the opposition has. Anybody who opposes Donald Trump and the racist white supremacist agenda will be crushed underfoot or expelled. That's how they talk. Charlie Kirk hasn't denied, by the way, an MSNBC reporter talked to him about some of these things he said, and he flatly just says, yes, I said that about Martin Luther King Jr. Watch this.
You've said some stuff on your podcast, and you've advocated against DEI.
Correct.
In that context, you've questioned whether you could trust black pilots.
That's
you've
correct.
Advocated for maybe...
Well, what did I exactly say, though?
We can play the clip
yes,
back.
Yes, you should.
It.
Yeah, you
and
should
I said
say,
it's in the context
according
of the
to the United Airlines hiring practices, they will lower standards and increase racial
Sure. So, I'm not debating, you know, what you said. But in the context of that, you've also questioned whether MLK should have a federal holiday.
Correct, yes.
Correct, yes. And then what happens invariably every single time, because this is the strategy, this is not happenstance, this is not coincidence. What happens is Fox News and the News Corp ghouls, they run with this. They run with the black church narrative that it's a real thing, that Donald Trump's really reaching out, and they praise him. They heap adulation upon the dear leader for being brave and bold enough to reach out to black America and go to a black church and bring the black and white communities together. Oh, Donald Trump, thank you. Thank you. And this from Ainsley Earhart. Before I get to that clip, though, I need to remind you, as I always do when I talk about Ainsley Earhart, exactly who she is. Here she is saying, what about the majority? I'm so sick of protecting the minority.
I do want to say that it is because we protect the rights of the minority, and there are listen, we have separation of church and state in this country.
What about the majority?
Okay, the majority.
I'm so tired of protecting the minority.
What about
the majority?
Okay, the majority.
I'm so tired of protecting the minority.
So it's that Ainsley Earhart, who is now praising Trump for reaching out to the minority vote, the minority community in the United States. Make it make sense and watch this.
When you see Trump at a black church, how wonderful is that? To know that not only, I mean, Christian values are important to many Americans, but also to connect the black and white communities. And for him to go to the black communities and say, what do you want me to do for you as a president? That resonates with the black community.
Tell me more, Lily White Ainsley Earhart, who's so tired of protecting the minority. Tell me more about what resonates with the black community. The congregation is a black congregation. There's all kinds of legal battles. They voted this pastor out as pastor, the deacons. He was actually arrested because they changed the locks on. They don't want him there. And he has just like a squatter. He thinks he has squatter's rights in the church, and there's a legal battle taking place right now. But the congregation, in overwhelming manner, was not there for that. Those were out-of-towners who are MAGA people, and they travel with Donald Trump. That's what that was. They claimed there was 8,000 people there in the tiny church because it's all lies. It's all subterfuge. It's all just theater. Performance art. If you will, because that audience, yeah, there were a couple black folks in there, but that was largely, overwhelmingly white people. But Trump doesn't care. Trump supporters don't care. The objective here is to try to make it seem, create an illusion of overwhelming national support for Donald Trump that does not exist. Certainly, Donald Trump still enjoys that roughly 32 to 34, maybe 36% of rock solid support of the country, which is alarming in and of itself, but he does not have a majority support among Americans by any measure whatsoever, other than the measures they provide, which are lying about rally size, lying about the overwhelming support of the black community and the Hispanic community in America. It's just lies so he can try to get back into office and then extricate himself from his legal troubles by attempting to pardon himself and dragging this whole thing out until he never serves jail time because he's so old he ends up dying. I think that's what's at play here. Anyway, I'd love to know what you think about it. You can have a conversation below in the comments. We can talk about it there. You can also call, leave me a voicemail, 714-576-4054. Of course, you can email me daily at dollamore.com. And if I am your flavor of political commentator, if you appreciate what I do, if I bring you some kind of value, please consider supporting this work, helping me make these videos. Click the join button, $2 a month to become a channel member. You can also go over to patreon.com/IDoubtItPodcast. That would be fantastic. I love and appreciate you, and I will see you next time. Until then, be genuine. Take care of one another.